As we discussed in Unit 1, all data in XNAT is stored in one of two places. All your metadata that defines projects, subjects, experiments, and assessors is indexed and stored in a Postgres database. And then all the resource files that are attached to those indexed items are stored in the XNAT file system. These two storage systems and how they interact form the core of how XNAT manages permissions, data, and searching. Every indexed item of data in Postgres is assigned a unique ID so that it can be operated on and be associated with other data. Projects get a unique project ID when they get created. All subjects and experiments get an accession ID. And scans are referenced both by a scan ID and their DICOM UID. All the metadata in Postgres for each of these entities is stored in a series of rows that are indexed by these unique IDs. Whenever a user initiates a request for data, whether it's through searching for data or wanting to modify data or even deleting data, the XNAT determines and controls its permissions on that action based on the relationship between that data's unique ID, the project ID of the project that owns the data, and the user's role in that project and what that level of permission is granted. So that takes care of projects, subjects, experiments, and assessors. Resources are a bit more complicated. Resource files in the file system are organized into collections. And that collection is referenced in Postgres with a unique ID, which enables project-based permissions control. Resource files are then stored in the file system in folders that are named after these collections, along with an XML catalog that lists everything in that collection. For an example, let's walk you through a typical MR session in XNAT. So here I'm looking at an MR session from one of our practical exercises in the Bogus NS project. The UI shows us that there are 486 files in this particular scan, and if we hover over the file count, we can see that all those files are located in a DICOM resource. If we open up the Manage Files console for this session, we can actually see two resource folders in here, one for DICOM and one for snapshots. If we open up the DICOM folder, we can see a listing of each of those DICOM files. Switching over to an SCP console, we can take a look at the XNAT file system itself. Here's the archive. This is where all the resources for our projects are stored. You'll notice that these resources are organized into a folder structure that comes close to mirroring the XNAT data structure, except that subjects are skipped. We go straight from projects to experiments. These folders are named according to the project ID and then each experiment's label and each scan's label. So if we go into scan 9, and then peek into the DICOM folder, we can see each of these DICOM files. Or we can also see the XML catalog file. Opening up the XML catalog file, we see that each file has an entry that contains the file name as a URI. And then it has a bunch of additional metadata as well that relates to the provenance of that data. Unlike experiments, which are indexed and searchable, these individual resource files are not indexed in Postgres, and the UI doesn't have direct visibility into the files on the file system. So XNAT depends on the accuracy of these XML catalog files in order to handle any operations that pertain to the files themselves, whether that's downloading or pipeline processing or something like that. Because the file system is abstracted in this way, it's possible for things to get out of sync, particularly if you've done any manual operations on the file system directly. If this does happen, it's possible to perform a catalog refresh. You can see our documentation for examples on how to do this. So that covers some of the details about how data is stored in XNAT and how permissions are controlled. In our next talk, we're going to get into installing support for new data types using plugins.